We've known them from childhood. Charming, funny birds that float in the tub. But ducks are full of surprises. Older than whales, they were one of the first creatures to return from land to the sea. Supremely adaptable, they have conquered every kind of water. Intensely social, they have rituals that reach back millions of years. Proven survivors, they're a perfect blend of wings and wind and water. Introducing ducks, a colorful cast of true originals. For 32 days, they've been developing, growing, transforming. Now their time has come. Urgently, they begin knocking on the door to the outside world, ready to break through. In their first moments of life, you can tell that they are ancient creatures. There are shades of dinosaur or miniature dragon about them. But as soon as they've had a chance to dry and fluff up a little, it's easy to see what they really are. Bright-eyed, downy ducklings. Each egg was laid a day apart, but they all hatch together within 24 hours. They will face the world as a family. They recognize their mother by her familiar voice. She's been softly cooing to them through their shells for the last few weeks. They imprint on her the moment they see her, sealing a bond that's the key to their survival. But even as they nestle into her feathers, a combination of excitement and hunger makes them eager to leave the nest. And at dawn, the very next morning after they hatch, their mother leaves and begins to call to them. She's calling them out of the nest. They don't hesitate. With small, sharp claws on the end of their webbed toes, they climb the sides of the nest. A daunting reality is waiting for each of them. Their safe and cozy home is some 70 feet up in the hollow of an oak tree. It's just the second day of her life. She can't fly. At this stage, she doesn't really have any wings to speak of. But she can see the ground far below and hear her mother's calls. Maybe courage comes from necessity. Maybe it comes in knowing from birth exactly what to do. She weighs less than an ounce and lands softly and safely in the leaf litter below. And one by one, ducklings rain down from the tall oak tree. Thank you. The siblings rally together on the forest floor. Their mother continues calling from the middle of a nearby pond. And with single-minded purpose and surprising speed, her brood sets off towards her. The tiny ducklings are unstoppable. Just ahead lies the world they were made for. And they take to the pond like, well, ducks to water. Out on the pond, a vision awaits them. Resplendent in feathers of green and chestnut, ornately patterned and trimmed in white, with bill and eyes of blazing red. The duckling's parents are North American wood ducks, dazzling members of a remarkable group of waterfowl. Ducks are complex characters. Fascinating and funny. Sophisticated and silly. Much of their lives we never see, yet they seem as familiar as a nursery rhyme. There are pintails, and buffleheads, eiders, widgeons, canvasbacks, and green-winged teals. More than 120 different species in all. On the land, they waddle. A comical combo of stout bodies, short legs, webbed feet, and a quack. But in the water, they glide. Each one a seaworthy little ship in watertight feathers. In the air, ducks are powerful flyers, winging their way across continents, some traveling thousands of miles in a single year. But no matter where they're headed, all ducks come home to water. It's in water that they make a living. Our wood ducklings were born knowing this. No parent provides for them. They start feeding all on their own the minute they enter the water. Their pond in spring is brimming with good things to eat. Tiny crustaceans and the larvae of aquatic insects cloud the water, turning the pond into a veritable duck soup. Although wood ducks dine on many plants, little woodies need more protein in their first weeks of life while they're building their bodies. They sift through the gooey pondweed, harvesting tiny invertebrates from the greenery. Their mother is never far away, but they don't need her to teach them the ropes. They need her to protect them. For like all ducklings, the woodies have entered the food chain smack in the middle. Their pond may be small, but it's complete. Hawks, foxes, even neighborhood cats take a terrible toll on little ducklings. Largemouth bass and hungry snapping turtles lurk in the murky waters. In some years, 9 out of 10 wood ducklings fall to predators within their first 2 weeks. And they are vulnerable even when full grown. Though the ducklings may look up to their parents, the adults are only 6 or 7 inches tall and weigh only about 1.5 pounds. Canada geese tower over them. So far this season, our wood duck family has been lucky. Their pond has been a remarkably safe place. At the end of the day, the mother shepherds her brood to a secluded spot that offers cover and protection. A male wood duck takes no part in raising the family. He will rest afloat in the center of the pond, or, true to his name, fly up into the safety of the trees to roost for the night. A duck's identity lies in more than its name. It all starts with how and where it eats. There's the water's surface, where dabblers float along, scooping up all kinds of plants and creatures that conveniently collect and grow there. But there's often something worth eating a little bit deeper. And with head down and bottoms up, they can just reach it. Other ducks go deeper. They're divers, finding food along rocky and sandy floors that dabbling ducks can't reach. Up and down they go, bringing up the daily catch. Of course, there's always someone who wants it both ways. Buffleheads are diving ducks, but this little female has spied something delicious just beneath the surface. She's not good at dabbling, but she can't resist. She gets no points for style, but she does get her prize. Ducklings know if they are divers or dabblers right from the start. And these little ruddy ducks were born to dive, just like their dad. The ducklings use their enormous feet to propel them down. It may be 6 weeks before the little ruddies take to the air, but in water, they already seem to fly. Growing up to be just like their parents is trickier for other chicks. This devoted mother and her bright yellow ducklings are actually not related at all. She's a female lesser scaup, and on close inspection, the little yellow chicks are redhead ducklings. They will develop into adults that look like this. Redhead females make a practice of laying some eggs in another duck's nest, leaving the raising and protecting of the hatchlings to someone else. The ducklings imprint on their foster mother, and she doesn't seem to notice that they're different. The yellow chicks tag along with the dark scaup chicks in one big, blended family. But when the adopted chicks grow up, they in turn will lay eggs in another duck's nest. It's a hedge against bad luck. And should a predator raid their own nests, having some eggs in another basket is a pretty good backup plan. Of all the things that shape a duck's character, water is one of the most powerful. From high-energy waters like this comes a very different duck. Torrent ducks revel in the tumultuous mountain rivers of the Andes in South America. They're the whitewater adrenaline junkies of the duck world, fearlessly leaping into the fastest water they can find. Everything about them is designed for this. From their extra-thick, rubbery feet to their long, stiff, rudder-like tail. This cold, clear water, however, is not rich in food. So each pair of torrents stakes out a stretch of river and defends it for all they're worth. They are one of the very few ducks to acquire their own territories. It's all about securing enough food to raise a family. And to take care of hers, the orange-breasted female sets off on a surprising climb. She's sitting on eggs on a cliffhanger of a nest. It's a home made of moss covered with a quilt of down, and it's perched some 60 feet above the river. Long before they're born, torrent ducklings are accustomed to the constant roar of whitewater. Their father, in striking black and white plumage, remains on patrol, watching over their territory. The ducklings are strong swimmers from the get-go. These rough waters are their world, and they're born ready for it. The woodies take their morning swim in much calmer waters. Ducklings grow up fast, and ours have already turned into teenagers. They still hang out together, absorbed with taking care of their sleek new feathers. They won't need their mother much longer. The young woodies have already taken a momentous step, one that will change their lives. They have finally learned how to fly. Getting up into the air is a complicated exercise, especially for ducks. They have relatively small and pointy wings, and two very different flight plans. Surface-dabbling ducks with small, light bodies can rise straight up, ascending almost vertically into the air. Heavier-bodied diving ducks need a long, watery runway to get enough lift to take off. And it takes a lot of flapping to get a chubby little bufflehead airborne. Once in the air, ducks maintain a fast pace. They don't have the wings for soaring. A bald eagle looks effortless alongside hard-working pintails. But even for an eagle, ducks are hard to keep up with. Given their body-to-wing ratio, ducks need to fly at high speeds to fly at all. Remarkably, delicate little green-winged teals have been clocked at almost 100 miles an hour. By midsummer, in duck waters everywhere, all the ducks have vanished. But they haven't flown away. You can still hear the unmistakable sound of 10,000 ducks chatting across the empty water. They're hiding, relying on the tall reeds for cover. All birds go through molt, replacing worn and tattered feathers with new ones. Usually, they replace flight feathers one at a time so they can continue to fly. But in a bold move, ducks drop all their flight feathers at once. They are temporarily grounded. Surrounded by plenty to eat, they don't need to take to the air. Yet, for the next 3 or 4 weeks, with no way to fly from danger, they are all sitting ducks. By late summer, when the molt is over, all the damaged, worn-out feathers have been replaced with strong, flexible new ones. And they are beautiful. Intricately patterned and shimmering with color. Some feathers are rich in dark pigments that help make them strong and resistant to wear and tear. But the most dazzling hues come from tiny crystals in the structure of the feather that scatter light in specific ways. It's nature's nanotechnology that makes the iridescent purples and blues and the brilliant greens that many ducks seem to favor. Staying bright and shiny usually starts with a bath. There's dust and dirt and parasites to deal with. Every feather must be combed out nice and flat, and then waterproofed. From a gland at the base of the tail, ducks spread a waxy ointment all over their plumage. The whole routine takes hours of nibbling and stroking and athletic contortions several times a day. It all concludes with a satisfying stretch, with every feather back in place. By the end of summer, a young wood duck is showing the first signs of his true colors. He's on his way to being a beautifully feathered male. But it will be another year yet before he'll be ready to put his plumage to the test. In the golden light of October, with iridescent feathers at their best, wood ducks go courting. Wood ducks pair up months before the breeding season. They gather in little groups of their own. Males to show off and outdo each other, and females to pick a new partner. Wood duck fidelity only lasts a single season. But once they have become a couple, they will spend the winter perfecting their bond. The young male is eager to be noticed. He attempts to chat up some females, but he doesn't find the right thing to say. All his attempts to woo go the wrong way. He's learning the painful truth that this game is not up to him. It's the female who decides who gets to mate. All the males are beautiful. What else is she looking for? Only she knows for sure. And suddenly, she finds it. Once he's been chosen, he'll have to be more than pretty. He'll need to work hard to protect her from all other males. If he doesn't, she'll have all winter to change her mind. Then, as the hours of daylight dwindle, their food sources diminish, and it's time to head south. All across the north, tens of millions of ducks take to the air. They will fly for many thousands of miles, following ancient routes. Taking turns flying point, ducks often form up into a V. All but the lead bird flies in the slipstream of the one in front of it, saving energy. Precisely how they navigate is a marvel and a mystery. They follow landmarks, use the sun as a compass, and track along lines of the Earth's magnetic field. Often, they depart at dusk, rising with the setting sun, winging their way into the night a mile or more above the ground. A map of stars now sparkles above them, guiding them on their way. It seems that from the very egg, ducks know where they are going. They land to rest and refuel along traditional flyways. Ducks can't carry reserves of body fat on migration, and their high speed and high metabolism burn right through their last meal. The location of good resupply stops is what ultimately determines the route they can take. But in the frenzy to feed, they are vulnerable. Redheads gather in tight groups, taking turns as lookouts while the others feed. Green-winged teals often work in pairs, one head up, the other head down. Shovelers swim in close circles, concentrating invertebrates for easier capture. But that leaves them with no eyes on the skies. A northern harrier hunts over the wetlands, looking for an exhausted or injured bird. But once on the wing, ducks are too fast for the hawk to catch. Predators or not, ducks dare not linger too long on a stopover. As the shovelers keep feeding, a snow squall catches up with them. There are a few ducks that defy winter. In spite of the cold, common goldeneyes stay far to the north in the food-rich Arctic Ocean, wherever there's open water. Even in the depths of winter, ducks stay a toasty 105 degrees inside their dense feathers. Their challenge is to prevent all that warmth from escaping into the icy water through their naked legs and big webbed feet. Their solution is to keep their feet almost as cold as the water. Special blood vessels cool the blood flowing to their toes and then warm it on the way back up. Their circulation stays strong, with no heat lost to the water. But now and then, it must be nice to tuck a cold foot into some nice warm feathers. It's the fishing in these Arctic waters that makes adapting to the cold worthwhile. And there's nothing like a little success to attract attention. A pair of red-breasted mergansers has flown in to test their luck. Their long, sharp, serrated bills are perfectly designed for seizing a slippery meal. As winter deepens, dense flocks of common eiders converge on rare patches of open water in the polar ice. In temperatures reaching 40 below, it's sometimes just the tightly packed presence of the ducks themselves that stops this last ocean patch from freezing over. What could possibly keep eiders in this impossible place through the winter? The answer lies just beneath the ice. Fighting a headwind of swift current, eiders use their powerful wings to reach a seafloor covered with high-protein clams, mussels, and urchins. This remarkable footage is unique. The first glimpse of ducks flying through the ocean. It also shows their difficult and dangerous work. Eiders have only a minute or so before running out of air, and a large flock can easily deplete the reachable seabed. All winter, they rely on the constantly shifting ice to open up new feeding grounds. Once they've pried a clam loose, they simply relax, and the air in their feathers brings them back to the surface. They swallow the catch whole. The calcium-rich shell will be ground up in the bird's gizzard and digested. In this way, seashells will recycle into eggshells come the Arctic spring. Most ducks handle winter by simply leaving it behind. In wetlands across the American South, ducks have taken refuge in bayous, bays, and creeks all through the Lowcountry. Our wood duck pair has landed on a pond in Florida, which is turning out to be a popular spot. The couple stays side by side, especially now that other wood ducks have gathered on the water. There appear to be quite a few bachelors in the group. And though it's not mating season yet, they're all looking to secure a partner. The male is on guard duty every waking moment. Males often outnumber females, so the others will steal her if they can, or at the very least, harass her constantly. That's why she chose a protector and a companion long before they arrived. Without a bodyguard, the female is in physical danger from aggressive and unwanted attentions. But our male is proving himself a worthy partner. He's been by her side through thick and thin, rain or shine, for better or for worse. At long last, spring is on the way. The Woody's world is turning green. With food sources due to bloom in the north, ducks everywhere are getting ready for spring migration. And for most ducks, that cues the most significant event of the year, the annual song and dance of courtship. Males decked out in their finest feathers begin doing just about anything to get noticed. Females all across the duck world sit and watch, judging. Thank you. Every performer follows finely tuned choreography selected and honed over thousands of years by their females as they pick the show that pleases them most. Of course, males get distracted and jealous of another's display. The males get so worked up, their frustration spills over into violent abuse of the females. Ducks are one of the few birds that suffer forced copulations. But mostly, it's the females who choose their partners. It's the drab, camouflaged mothers-to-be who are actually responsible for the dashing colors, the splendor of the males. Then there's the strange case of the Australian musk duck. It seems that these females have a very different idea of good looks. They've cultivated males that look much like themselves, only much larger and with an odd leathery lobe beneath their bills. The musk duck fans his tail, strikes a pose, and whistles. To top it off, he releases a musky scent. If he gets it right, the female will find him irresistible. Our female Woody, like all of her kind, has chosen a beauty. He's been a faithful guardian all winter, and finally, she approaches him as a partner in the dance. She performs a series of head bobs, splashing water with her bill. He deliberately turns away to show her the bright white stripes on the back of his crest. Then she flattens herself against the water, a signal to him that she's ready to mate. And so the story begins anew. The wood ducks have chicks on the way. She finds a protected nest site high up in a tall oak tree, in a cavity where a tree branch once grew. Down in the nest, she makes everything ready. She plucks the feathers from her breast, spreading out the perfect down blanket for eggs and chicks. He stands guard, keeping predators away from the nest and competitors away from his female. She lays her eggs, one per day, and keeps them warm, turning them, talking to them, patiently waiting until that magic moment when eggs turn into ducklings. Soon, their mother will call them out to a waiting world. They were born to master the wind and the water, and plucking up their newborn courage, they answer the call.